is rather large, and that one's at the very back, if you want to take that one. You can just pass those on, that'd be great. So a song is a combination of words and music. In folk songs, there are some peculiarities both to the words and the music that help to make them identifiable as folk songs. Now, it's on paper, this talk is about British folk songs, and just to clarify why an Irishman is giving that talk, there is really one tradition of English language traditional songs between this island and the one I'm from, and those songs continue to move around a lot, and it can be really, it's a really brave person that says that's an Irish song, that's an English song, because that's kind of relevant, even if it's a song set in London, that song could be from part of Ireland, and all that's changed is the name of, you know, there was a maid from London town, or maybe it used to be there was a maid from Dublin town, and the two have for centuries continued to move between the two, and you know, people now really who are very into it in an academic way wouldn't refer to there being two separate traditions at all. Where you do get more considered boundaries is between languages, but even that's permeable, and songs can be translated between Scots Gaelic, Irish Gaelic, Welsh, whatever. Songs move as easily as people, and you know, anybody who's, you know, in this room could do a straw poll to people from all over the world. People move and songs move with them, simple as that.
I think it might be a good idea, James, if some people can share the sheets, because I think they ran out here somewhere.
Have we run out? Yeah, kind of done it. They're really, I mean, I can email.
For that end, isn't there?
Does anybody at the back of it?
Nobody got any over there.
Do you want to just move a few sheets back? There, I mean, if you want to take them out of yourselves, I mean, these are. Thanks,
you want to share a couple there?
Can you pass the
anyone have any like large one?
You bring your glasses.
They're really, the notes don't make sense hugely in between themselves. They're really just a kind of structure of what could very dangerously be a totally rambling talk. Okay, so folk songs. The key word there is folk, and it's very important to remember how social folk songs are, both in where they come from and in how they travel around. As I said, as people move, songs move with them, and that is one of the really, really key things to remember about these traditional songs, is that they're from a social context, and they tell you a lot about those people, those communities, and the places that they're collected from, and you get a lot of place names coming up as I mentioned, but those change hugely. And in that, they are traditionally orally transmitted. Now, it was mentioned in the opening panel by Simon that, you know, once you record a song or write it down, you know, the danger is that it can ossify it, and you're now preserving it rather than conserving it. Because these songs have, for hundreds of years, many of them, been transmitted by one person singing it, people hearing it, and, you know, from a few listens, probably, learning it. And that is a beautiful way to transmit a song, but obviously, it's not a digital copy. It will change either deliberately or unconsciously. Verses will be dropped. Other verses will be added in to beef back up. Place names will change. People's names will be misheard, or you know, somebody might put in the name of a person they're familiar with. And what you get is this wonderful evolution of just an individual song. And over time you get an evolution of a whole repertoire of songs, and you know, songs get lost, maybe they become less popular, you know, certain topics might might be politically sensitive, and those songs, you know, in a certain generation can disappear and then pop back up. The word traditional is a tricky one to approach, because we're all inclined to do as we've seen done before. Within any group, let's say the Irish traveller community that will be that we've been reporting with a lot, there are what are seen as traveller songs that have been very, very popular within certain families, in certain areas, and those are the really revered songs, and it's, you know, that people are very keen to see youngsters learning. And they may not be known outside of traveller communities, a lot of them. Although, you know, I think in the last 50 years we've certainly become quite aware through recordings and through people performing more that they're getting out there. But to be seen as traditional songs from inside the culture is a very key thing, and there can be a huge differentiation between what is seen as a traditional song and a popular song that's commercially available. The word local is key, because a lot of songs, as I mentioned earlier, are relocalized to be relevant to the places that people are from. So hearing a lyric that identifies a song as being from an area doesn't necessarily mean song has always been from there at all, because that can easily change. Another trait of these folk songs is that they are inevitably narrative, the vast majority of them, there's exceptions always, they're not rules at all, and there's a story within them which will progress verse by verse, often very, very familiar stories, and I'll go through a few of those a bit later on. And the songs are traditionally sung unaccompanied, solo, no instruments. When the collectors such as Cecil Sharp and that around the turn of the last century were publishing their songs, they often set them to piano scores, because that's what people were interested in. Time they wanted to play them at home on the old piano 40, and but the songs were never really sung with any accompaniment, and that's true across the British Isles. Now, before I go any further, is this making sense? Is there anything that I've glossed over that anybody's unclear about the kind of songs that I'm talking about? There are so many of these, it's not going to be interactive.
Is there a reason to name all of these sort of things?
None of these are rules. So, I mean, any one of these things can be an exception. And I don't want to get into talking about too many specific examples of songs, because very quickly everything I'm saying will fall apart, because you'll say, well, this one is this. So, this doesn't mention anyone. This one isn't particularly narrative. But these are some of the traits that you tend to get more into folk songs.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't mean to sort of go off on my goal on tangent. But basically, because you're talking about songs that are like this, obviously you record them, you preserve or conserve a particular version of a particular person of a song that's a living thing that goes and goes around. It's not like a commercial product, or you copyright every single bit of the arrangement or every single word in it. It's a completely living thing. So the thing is, really, how do you actually, not only you know, keep this version, how do you keep this tradition going? Because, you know, if all you keep is the recordings, then that's still the death of the song.
Yeah.
Because these songs, to be traditional, to be what they are, they have to keep on living, they have to keep changing. Yeah.
Yeah. I think from the recordist's point of view, what they can do there is record many different versions. and never claim that this is the definitive version. They can say it's their favourite or whatever, well, entitled to our opinion. Trying to record the completest version of a song is really helpful. But, I mean, God, there's songs I've been singing for years and I'm still coming across verses for them that can fit in. But as a discerning singer, I would choose not to, because the song's already bloody 10 verses long. And if I'm struggling to remember it, then I'm sure people are struggling to listen through the whole thing. But I think somebody might find that verse that I decide not to sing the best verse of the song. So to save it for whoever I might be in the future, I think is a nice thing to do for their sake, even though I might not be inclined to sing it. Or I might just find it offensive. There might be a sample to it. Yes?
Just in the definition of folk song, would you add in there something about the origins of it, obscure, it's not recognized by the song? Can somebody write
Just that the origins of the song might not be known. It's something that I will get to. That a lot of these traditional songs are, you often see the word anonymous or author unknown or something like that. And that's really a key result of the orality of how they're transmitted, that it's because they're isn't a recording or a printed text, that is very, very hard to trace for sure the origins of the song and who wrote it. And there have been, as the songs get passed on, there have been so many authors shaping these songs, reshaping these songs, that they have been collectively written, essentially, many of them. The more recent ones, less so, obviously, because they've been around less time, but as they're passed on, they will definitely change and evolve. Eli?
Just along similar lines, I think putting the song in context is so important. So not just recording the actual song, but recording everything around it, the stories of how someone wrote the song, the sense of place that we get when we hear the song.
Yeah, and that's something I think that lends itself to these narrative songs particularly. There's so much meaning in the songs that, you know, there's a lot to interpret in them, and a lot of those interpretations differ and even conflict with each other. And finding out what somebody's interpretation of a story is can really, I mean, you know, that can bring the song to life for you. It can really make it meaningful. And a lot of the older singers will say, but of course that's a true story, and I know the person it's about. And then you might meet somebody who says, oh, that's a true story, and I tell you it's about, and they're two completely different stories. Doesn't really matter. We're not approaching this, I hope, as in too formal a historical way, because, you know, as historical documents, they don't, you know, a lot of these songs will not tell you what happened so much as how people felt at the time. And historical documents are much better at giving you facts and figures. But what a song can give you as poetry of the time, or memoirs of the time can give you, is that very, very personal experience. And as an orally transmitted thing, what you get is a sense of the collective experience. Because if somebody sang a song, an event that's very familiar to me from the part of Ireland I'm from is a rebellion that happened in 1798. And songs that were sung around that time by the local communities, they wouldn't have been passed on unless people agreed with the sentiments of the song to then learn it and sing it themselves. So you can get a very strong sense that if a song has survived for even 20 or 30 years after those events, that must be there must be a consensus in that song that maybe the events didn't exactly happen like that, but that the emotion in the song must have been shared by people, because they wouldn't have got away with singing it. You know, I mean, if I was to sing a really offensive song now, I doubt anybody here would feel really inclined to learn it, unless you agree with the sentiments of the show. Okay, now one of the these songs, of course, is that they are old. And when Sam and I have met up with people to try and explain the kind of songs we're looking for, we can dance around all these really, really tricky words like folk song, ballad, traditional song, and they can be very, very difficult for people to grasp, and people interpret them in different ways. A really, really easy way just to explain what we're looking for is to say, no, no, the really old songs, you know, and they totally get it, and everybody knows what an old song is. It's amazing, really, that you know, people who don't even sing the songs themselves, they can tell by the sound of it, the sense of it, the words used in it maybe are a big clue that it is really old. And we're talking, for a lot of these songs, a couple of hundred years old, and with a few of them still going after 700 years, you know, even by volume standards, that's pretty old. And one of the things that I find beautiful about a lot of these songs is that they're old, and that they have been preserved and carved like pebbles in a river over a long time. And it's amazing that they have survived. And you know, there's an awful lot of people, anonymous people, involved in getting them to us, to our generation. And one of the tricky things that I won't dwell on, that we can really avoid as song collectors or anybody involved in this kind of art form, by collecting old songs, the thing we can avoid is copyright issues. More recent songs will still be in copyright, and you know, you need to get the author's permission to do anything with them. What doesn't get around, of course, is the copyright that the singer has, and as Pete addressed earlier, you have to be very clear with people what you're recording songs for and what you intend to do, and get their express permission, and you have to be able to back that up. So if it's on a recording that you've made, that they're very clearly stating that that's helpful, but a piece of paper with a signature on it is your best bet. I won't go any more into that, it's a whole topic in itself. Okay, social singing and transmission. A lot of traditional singers will not do concerts like what we're going to hear this afternoon, and indeed, as Sam said, Frida Black has never done anything like this. But people like Anthony Robertson, and Thomas McCarthy, who you know are conduits of these ancient songs, do a bit of that, you know. But traditionally there are songs sung at home or in campfires, and of course that changes in the modern era as well, because I expect very few of us here sit around campfires very often. And for me, there are songs that I sing in the shower, cycling my bike, and if anybody cares to listen, then they do, you know, and sing for them. But it's very important to remember that these are traditionally songs sung at home, and there is a tendency, a trend, that men historically would have sung these songs more publicly, and women more domestically. And a lot of the collectors over the years have found that the people with the more extensive repertoires are women, for whatever reason. I don't know if there's any.
Is that your experience, Peter?
Some of the elderly people who contribute that, but I've heard men's songs as well. So
right.
I don't know if it's true.
Okay.
Some of the most extensive work that I've heard.
Yeah, in my experience as well, actually. So, okay, well maybe leave that myth. Yeah. Yeah, I think, you know, we're a gender divided society, less so than we were, but I.
There are some songs which, because of the nature of the song, we're not singing with this company in the first place.
Yes, yeah.
But I have recorded very boring songs, and all the way.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and of course, a lot of the older songs, there might be in the first person, so I am a young sailor, I am a young maiden, and those songs could be sung by either gender, and they wouldn't be obliged to change the gender, because it's you're kind of a bit you're a bit removed from the person you're singing about. It's not it's never really a personal song, because it's merely passing through. Anthony, did you?
Yeah, I was going to say, the Robertson Stewart traveller families, where I've come from the Northeast, was many much more women singers, like Isabel Stewart, my great aunt Jean Robertson, her daughter Lizzie Higgins, and of course Stewart's of Mintlow, Fitterangus. My father, Stanley, was probably the only male singer of any renown that I knew of that particular extensive family, and of course myself.
Yeah. I mean, I think probably in different families there might be bigger divides about who sings, whether it's men or women, but certainly no hard and fast rules. Absolutely, yeah. Well, by nature of those communities, they were nomadic, really. It's not a word that we tend to use, but of course, the travellers in Ireland certainly would move from one community to the other because of the skills they had would only be needed irregularly as tints and sails, commonly known. But of course, they were also passed through with a lot of culture and news and information that people were interested in, and you know, people were so isolated up until 100 years ago, and transport became easier, that for people to be moving between those communities, transmitting the songs, and of course, people moving between Ireland and Britain, that they were huge transporters of culture, of new songs, as well as old songs.
Yeah. I also wonder if there's a link between travel, gypsy storytelling, which transmitted gender.
Yeah.
And the travel music transmission. I wonder if there's a link between how they transmitted.
I'm sure there is. I don't know much about storytelling, but I think it's important to not lose sight of the huge connection between telling of stories, not just stories about songs or connected to songs, but tales in themselves. And I spoke a bit earlier about how there are language barriers between songs more so than national barriers. National barriers are pretty much invisible to songs, really. But stories move much more easily through language barriers. I would imagine one of the reasons that they can do that is a song is written in verse, and sometimes it won't quite work when you translate, but you can translate a story much more easily, unless it's based on puns, then you've got to work with it through then. But so very stock stories will crop up all over the world. There's some very familiar stories, but within you see that slightly less within traditional songs. But there are so many stock songs, lots of familiar themes, which I would call to the poems. So stock opening lines, stories, motifs and characters, you know, in ballads, lots of sailors and different rural things popping up. But tailors was always one that I noticed. The tailor, for whatever reason, never does well in a traditional song. He's usually the one that gets caught out. He's usually what's the word? Sexually not the most lucky character. If he ever has a chance at getting a bit of action, he usually doesn't things don't go so well. I have no idea why, you know, the tailor is always gets the raw deal there, but it pops up in lots of different songs. So still to come across one of the tailor as well, you know. And lots of familiar opening lines, for example, and you can spot fairly old song starting with "Come all you," certainly in Ireland, and that leads to another familiar phrase for an old song, which is a "Come all you," which might start with "Come all you gallant seamen," or the one that's working with the 1798 rebellion in my home county, and the song goes, Come all you warriors and renowned nobles. And I don't think there was many renowned nobles listening to those noble songs back then, but that's a very familiar beginning, you know. As well as I Roved Out, there's an old radio program called As I Roved Out, or As I Went Out Walking. And by season setting there, you'll get a lot of songs that will begin with, it was in the month of, and it's usually in the month of May. I know Lisa Knapp, which is here, can be a song with the month of May. I think really why a lot of songs are set in May and June, as well as there being a bit warmer and stuff going on, they're quite easy to rhyme with. If you were starting off within the month of February, you're making things a bit tricky. Well, there is a song.
Are you saying they waited until May to write them?
I don't know when they wrote them. They had it very hard. Well, there is a song in the month of January. It doesn't rhyme with itself, but that's the. Okay, and some of the familiar stories, "Broken Token." Say, a few people here probably know what "Broken Token" song is. Who doesn't know what "Broken Token" song is? Excellent. A "Broken Token" song. The token is a token of love. Quite often a ring, sometimes a locket or something else, and it's been broken in half, and one lover takes one, and the other lover takes the other, and they are separated. Now, quite often the man goes off to war or goes off to sea to be a sailor and comes back and to test his love, he will ask, he'll be in disguise, he may have grown a beard or some such convincing disguise or not a haircut. And the lover is so, the female lover is so at a loss and missing her lover so much that she doesn't actually recognize him when he turns up. And he'll say, he'll introduce himself as somebody else and say, will you marry me? And she'll say, no, I'm betrothed to my lover who's far away at sea. And he'll be so happy that his lover is being true to him, even though he's the person that is being rejected, that he will produce the other half of this broken token. And she realizes, oh, it's you. You got your hair cut. I didn't recognize you. You look so different with that beard. But knows it's him, and that's proof. And the broken token is the key thing. And that's the thing. Is that a broken token song? Yeah.
May, I think,
it's
just such an outburst after winter.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's plenty to... There's more to say about the month of May than the month of February, certainly. Yeah. But I stand by it, though. I think, you know, if you're writing a song,
since many of the songs that do have these things to do with this, the relationship between man and woman is much nicer than the one away.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And when you can poetically talk about the lambs who've just been born and any kind of birds and bees and whatnot. It's a bit more poetic, yeah. And we
To be listed under the heading Broken Token, the song does not necessarily have to have a physical broken token mentioned in it.
Yeah.
That's a fair point. Like have the ring, but yeah. Have the issue of like Lord Lovett's lament. I'm thinking Charlie Mackey, yeah. Where the guy tries to marry the girl, father doesn't approve.
Yeah.
The guy goes away. He joined the army. Then 7 years later, when she's in Aberdeen, soldiers on the links parading, has to be her.
Yeah.
The girl takes a fancy to the boy. Would you marry me? No, I'm waiting for my true
that's
Charlie Mackey. Has to be him.
Yeah, and you get that theme of separated lovers. As much as you'd get the kind of familiar Romeo and Juliet scenario where, for either reasons of family or fortune or whatever, that two lovers can't be together. I mean, there a lot of this stuff, when you kind of think about it in a broader context, is pretty familiar from soap operas now. You get a lot of those stories or cheap magazines, there's
nothing new, is there, in the world?
No, there's nothing new under the sun, certainly, and I think as people we're as interested in the body and heartbreak and war and violence and all that stuff as we ever were, and we like our art to reflect those good and bad things about life. A night visiting song is another familiar form in which the lover will come to his lover at night, usually approaching the bedroom window and ask him to be and the lover awakes and initially won't let him in, but then lets him in, and you'll get then lots of innuendos of what might have gone on. I always like a very subtle one. They both shook hands and embraced each other, and I won't even go into what that possibly might mean, but I think it suggests a hell of a lot more than shaking hands. And there's always mentioned a cock crone as well, I think.
Yeah.
Generally a bit of a nod and a wink there. And quite often in those songs, as the cock crows in the morning, the lover must leave. And quite often it's sometimes more subtly done, but sometimes very clear that the lover who's visiting is dead, and it's his ghost or it's his dead body that has arisen, and there will be lines in it explaining that the clay has changed me, love, you know, his lips aren't red anymore, that kind of stuff. And sometimes it's far more subtly, you can't even discern whether the lover's dead or just been away for a long time. And sometimes the lover's almost certainly not dead, it's just visible. But that structure, I don't know, I've had people sing the song and you say, is the lover dead in that song? It's kind of hard to tell. But they've been singing the song for 50 years.
Yeah.
Well, if you put in that other verse, he's dead. I don't sing that, you know. And but the story still works, and it's open to interpretation. That's a night visiting song. Lots of those. And then you'll get lots of historical events with huge amounts of songs around them. I've been more familiar with the Irish ones. You know, certainly 1798, where I'm from, there are hundreds of songs written about that. Bula Vogue is kind of a more familiar one to a lot of people. But you know, shipwrecks, you know, and any kind of a local event of note that people are interested in. There will be local songs about, and they'll get picked up or used as a template for other similar events, such as hangings or crimes. They're such, unfortunately, commonplace things that somebody will be murdered, and the murderer hung for that crime, that the song can be recycled for different events merely by changing the name. And when we get into, I suppose we're talking 1700s and 1800s, when songs were being printed on sheets known as broadsides, that there was a couple of pennies to be made by printing a popular song. And of course, a hanging and a murder was a great way to make a few bob. So whoever just been hung or murdered would have their name inserted in this song, and suddenly the ballad of Ed Hicks was out, and everybody knew how you'd murdered her and how you'd to be hung. And that could have even been sold at the hanging, you know, or soon after, and then there was somebody the next week.
Would those songs way back then have been able to make, they were like songs of Miss Justice or of that sort of nature, would they have got to nobility? So where they do say, come all ye men, warriors and nobles, would they have actually got into the heads of the nobility, or would they have been passed up that way?
No, I don't think so really. I mean, probably a few, but I think you're talking about the lower classes singing these songs.
So it's just for themselves rather than kind of political.
Yeah, I think you get a lot of lords and ladies in the songs, but I think the kind of music